Welcome to the Swirl Suite. You can follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook at Swirl Suite. Check out all of our episodes on YouTube and as podcasts on iTunes, SoundCloud, Stitcher, and Google Play. On this episode, myself, Vine Me Up, Vino Noir, and Girl Meets Glass talk Alsatian wines. Be sure to tweet along with us with the handle and hashtag Wines of Alsace. Cheers.
Welcome to the Swirl Suite, everybody. Hey guys, what's up?
Hello. How are you?
It's 80 degrees in D.C. I can't complain. Can't
complain. Yeah. LA to here.
Can't complain.
Like 60. Mm-hmm. Are Detroit blossoms up in D.C.?
They are. The parade was this past weekend. They took a while because we had a rough, I don't know, we just had a weird winter. So, I don't know. It's weird. They're up, though.
They came out. They went back.
Changing the weather, too. It's bad.
Really?
America's climate change.
Mm-hmm. Bad. Mm-hmm. Bad.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, how was your week? Did anybody do anything fun, Tanisha?
Why me? It's only Tuesday, so no, I haven't done anything fun.
Why are you lying? Where'd you just come from?
Oh, last week was fun. Yes. No, that last week was fun.
Oh my God. Please tell the people what you did last
week. Oh, so last week, I was, a part of the tasting jury of the Feminalized Wine Competition in, Beaune, France. And, they said we judged over 4,500 wines total.
Wow.
I personally tasted 40. Mm. So at the end of the night, people were like, oh, what you gonna do after this? I was like, I need to sit down.
Wait, so like, wait.
Because people were like, oh.
I watched some
like,
of your snacks.
Don't you spit? I was like, yeah, I spit, but...
Like, did you spit everything? Because I know you were tasting champagne at one point. I was watching some of your snaps.
So the champagne was the beginning.
Okay.
So I didn't drink any of the champagne because that was like the first thing I tasted. Mm. Those are the first seven. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, okay, I can't drink these. but my first tasting was 20 and then, 19. So actually it tasted 39. My bad. So my first tasting was 19. And then I had wine at lunch. Like, I drank wine at lunch.
Mm.
Then I tasted 20 wines after that. The final wines were Côte du Rhône, and then they were also Fougère from London.
Mm-hmm.
So
yum.
I drank the last three. I just drank those. I was like, listen, drinking these. I don't care what anyone says. And then they had an Aperol afterwards. So Aperol equals happy hour. So all the bottles of everything that they had and everything that anyone judged.
Oh my God.
So you could go back and drink.
So you could just go and pick up bottles.
Oh no. Nah.
Wow.
Oh no.
So it was a few hundred bottles on the table.
Oh my God.
Any rare finds that, you know, you might not normally get a chance to drink or because they're rare or they're just that expensive that they had that you're like, okay, let me get this.
Yeah, so I wasn't able to grab those because those people are vultures, but there were, I mean, literally vultures. But there were some amazing wines from Burgundy that they had out there.
Oh, wow.
That I would normally drink in certain years. Some things that I wouldn't have access to, like Luberon from out of Provence. So straight red wines out of Provence. Because, you know, wow. In the States, you're getting rosés out of Provence.
Sure.
But red wines from Provence are literally amazing.
I've never had a red wine from Provence.
If you could ever get your hands on a red wine from Provence.
I'll have some. We have to get together. I brought some back.
So Glennis, you already know, like the straight up red wines are like the rosés, you know, the rosés are amazing.
Phenomenal,
if you are fermenting that with the skins and doing everything and not pulling anything out.
That's why they're like still on in the cellar like this, like they're the baby. What am I going to do? Because I can't have
cult. Yeah, and then I tasted some Cote Jerome that were fantastic. You know, the wines that continue to surprise me because I don't taste them often and I forget that this is France, but Corsica.
Ooh.
Sure. Yeah.
I regularly forget that Corsica is France because, real talk, until I moved here, I thought Corsica was Italy. So, pardon me.
My geography. I think too.
Right, listen, I can't know everything. I can't know that. I can't know everything about everything. So, I thought Corsica was Italy because it sounds Italian, so whatever. But Corsica is what we call it in America. In French, it's Corse.
Oh, okay. Course.
So it's France, and some red wines out of that region are, as Glennis would say, they are phenomenal.
Phenomenal.
Those wines are phenomenal.
I'm about to take your lead and move too.
They are.
Girl.
So, yeah, and about moving, I don't know if I would suggest this site for everyone, just based on how different it is as far as, like, administrative stuff, but to come here for a few months and then go back home and then come here for a few more months, drink some more wine, and then go back, yeah. But, yeah, the wines from Corse and then also the red wines from Provence, those were the ones really
kind of blew my mind. Duly noted. Glennis, you want to tell the folks?
Stuff about that.
You said you're going to blog about it, Tanisha?
Yeah.
Okay. Glennis, you want to tell the folks about the dinner that we attended last week?
Tell us. But it's not Alsace, so yeah, we'll talk about
it. It's not, you know, we just.
But it was fun.
We're selling a lifestyle here.
Exactly. We tasted some phenomenal wines from Turkey, the Vinçara label, and all indigenous grapes, which I'm not even going to sit here and try to destroy. I think I remember Narence was one, an un-oaked version and an oaked version. And surprisingly enough, Saria and I think we had to both had the same reaction. We're like, this oak version on a white.
Right.
Phenomenal. Exactly. Because, you know, we both have kind of like the same palate, loving the un-oaked on the white wines. But that was crisp, fresh, fruit, citrus forward. Oh, it was just phenomenal. With a hint of oak, but it wasn't oaked. So it was just phenomenal. It was just phenomenal. Yeah, the oak was. But just enough to, you know, give it some structure. Let's see. The red wines, again. Yeah, those. Wish I could get them readily accessible here. One of the reasons why Artish, the winemaker, and the land that she grows these indigenous grapes on have been in her family for over several decades. And she'd come to the United States and did some studies and went back. And in hotel and hospitality industry, went back home and they opened up some, not bed and breakfast, but some like, bed and breakfast, some small boutique style properties, and finally convinced her family to start cultivating grapes on their properties. And their mission is to spread the word of the quality of the indigenous grapes of Turkey in that particular Ankara, I think that's how you pronounce it, Ankara area. And again, the wine is very, very, very well made.
Fantastic.
We did have a Greek sparkling aperitif while we were waiting for the dinner to start.
Of course, we go through a bottle of
Greek sparkling wine.
Of course.
That's close to Turkey.
Yeah.
Yeah, if you don't know Scilero, geography, whatever.
I can't pronounce that great.
Okay, I know what you're talking about.
That great, yeah. Mm-hmm. It was a rosé.
Yeah.
Phenomenal as well. It was a great start to the evening. So we did have a very...
And then we had the Turkish sparkling, right? Was that from Turkey?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, that was really interesting.
And that was the 100% Narinch grape again?
Yeah, I think so.
Oh, again, we just had a very, 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 very great evening. And, you know, it's always a pleasure to taste new grapes and new varietals and made into very well quality wine. So I think we tasted six different styles of grapes from that particular area in Turkey. Yeah. So I think that sums that up.
Yeah, but it was awesome.
Fine.
Yeah, it was really good.
But, good people too.
Yeah. So we're talking, wait, okay. So do you guys say Alsace or Alsace?
I think I say Alsace, which is probably wrong.
Alsace. It's so much easier to say Alsace, but Tanisha, what do they say in France? Alsace.
Oh, yeah. Okay. And I'm like, I can't say Alsace anymore since, like, I know two French words, so I can't say Alsace.
So it's all sauce.
It's Alsace, but Alsatian.
Oh, what? Okay.
Okay, that I did not know. It's all sauce, but Alsatian.
Okay.
Okay. All right, I'm gonna try to run with that. We'll see. Yeah. So I think Alsace is really unique because it's on the border of Germany and France, and their wines are just so crisp and so really good. And like I don't know, like you guys know, I love food, but I really, really love seafood.
Really?
And oh my god, and all Alsatian wines with seafood is fantastic. Fantastic. But
I want to say something right quick to just interrupt you briefly. Please. You mentioned that they are right across the border from Germany. They a fun fact that I learned when I was doing some research on it, since you know I do wine tours here and I talk about all the wines of France. Mm-hmm. They actually speak German in the Alsace region of France.
Yes, they do.
Yep. So I thought that was interesting. And then also, if you look at the shape of the wine bottle of Alsace, it is the shape of German wine bottles. It has the, you know, slender. Like you have it all. Yeah. It's slender and it has the little shoulders. Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. And they can have the, they are the only AOC or region in France that can have the grape on the front label of the bottle.
Yes.
Wow.
No one else can has it on the front.
The more you know. Yes.
And to add to that, the area of Alsace went back and forth between France and Germany
several times
from wars and France won.
Okay. Go France.
Did you just dab? I'm done.
We had to dab wrongs.
Sorry.
So really quickly, so Tanisha, correct me if I'm wrong, but so Alsace is 90% white and 10% red. So, so the white grapes that are grown in Alsace, Riesling, Pinot Gris, Muscat, Gewurztraminer, Pinot Blanc, Sauvignon, and is that it? Did I miss any? But those are all the white grapes.
It might be another.
Don't they have Pinot Blanc, Pinot Noir?
Yeah, Pinot Noir is the red. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, you talk about the white grapes.
Right,
okay.
Yeah, those are the white grapes, and the one red grape grown in the area is Pinot Noir. Is that right?
Yep.
That is probably right.
Yeah.
You know what? I'm about to pull up my information on Alsace.
Do it.
I'm pretty sure they grow Pinot Blanc.
I think they do, and it's one Chardonnay other. I'm thinking of that girl, but I want to say it if they don't. But carry on with the whole.
No, that was wanted to, you know, I wanted to give a little.
Oh no, I'm like carry on with the hangout. I don't want to, you know. I don't want
to. So in the way. Okay, so I wanted to find out why the typical Alsatian bottle is so slender. But I don't know if I got an accurate answer or not, but this I did not know. So I didn't know that a wine bottle is shaped based on the lung capacity of a human being. So when, yes, based on the way that glass was blown out back in ancient times, it's the lung 750 milliliters is the capacity of a human lung. And they got special individuals could blow more for the magnum bottles. But 750, that's why that's the size of the wine bottle. And I just read that the Alsatian glass bottle is slender like this because it was just easier to store. That's all I found out. But
fun fact.
Anybody find anything else out?
No. I find that interesting because if Alsace because of the altitude, I could see that their lung capacity might be less, and that's why it's slender.
See, now
that's the scientist. That's the nerd.
That's some good shit right there. That's
right. Because they're like, we're in the mountains.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
It's the altitude, so it's like oxygen is a little less, or you know, so. I can see that being slender. So
oxygen here,
instead of.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So
that's so funny.
And I thought it was just because that's how it was in Germany, and Germany was like, "Well, this is how we do it, so this is how y'all can do it." So
could be that too. Yeah, but sure. Since
any, any questions? Yeah. This is how we doing it. So y'all need to do it. Boom.
So Glenn, it's like, what is everybody drinking today? Tanisha, I know it's like probably like 2 a.m. in France for you, but Glennis, what are you drinking?
I can tell you what I drank 2 hours ago.
I don't know how to make my screen bigger, so do y'all have a good size? Because I'm looking through the thing. Okay,
no,
so that's
fine.
Just for me. Okay, people, you know my skills. I am drinking.
Okay.
Cremant d'Alsace. Alsace. From
I love that label.
Isn't it adorable? The orange is freaking outstanding. And I don't know how I'm gonna hopefully
come through curvy lady with the wings. Right.
Okay, so podcasters, it's the label of like a curvy woman with butterfly wings.
Yes, it is.
Orange label, so fly.
Right. And I think you pronounced the winemaker Zinc. Z-I-N-C-K. And I love the back of this label because anytime you have a label that gives you this much detail on what you're about to buy, it's outstanding. So I'm going to show y'all. Hopefully
and
you
that
can
does
see.
Not, and that does not always happen when you talk
about
France.
Oh, I can see the...
Oh, you can see it
tells you the levels.
France usually gives you 25% of that. They're like, you got a Cremant, this is the name of it. Goodbye.
Exactly. So this particular one from Domaine Zinc, I don't know how to pronounce it. I don't want to screw it up. Anyway, it gives you... how long you could store, you should store it. It gives you the level of sweetness and it gives you the grapes that are in it, of course, but, and the temperature you should store it at, which is outstanding.
Impressive.
This particular Cremant again is made method traditionnel. It is three grapes that they use three grapes in this one, the Pinot Blanc, Pinot Noir. Those two give it the structure, and the Chardonnay, which gives it the actual fruitiness and the Christmas. This particular Cremant has finesse, stone fruit. It's just exotic. It almost, when you first taste it, it feels like it's light because of the mousse, meaning the bubbles, which are so fine and they dissipate very well. But then the weight of the wine itself on the palate, it's almost like it's full bodied. without it's just a hint of biscuit on it. So you do have some biscuit notes, which are traditional for, you know, Cremants and Champagnes from France. But this one is outstanding. It retails for about $34.99.
Okay.
And again, I was in a wine store. I'm not giving them no credit.
Why don't
get
that?
No discount. Because if I give you my car, I don't get no discount. You don't get no pub. So there you go.
Yeah.
That's how we gonna do this from now on. If you give me 5-10% off, then okay. Yeah. But I was in a wine store.
5% won't even do it for me. You need to give me at least the tax off. Like I need to feel like I'm getting some.
There you go. See, so I don't feel too bad. You heard it from her first.
Yeah.
But so it's $34.99. It retails for $34.99. And I was in the store. I was like, that's sexy. Let me see that. Come on, Alsace. We're doing that. Yay. Mm-hmm. Let me buy it. Yeah. So, yeah. It's a brew. So, you know, it's extra dry and phenomenal.
Yeah.
It's worth it. It's worth every day.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Really quick, I want to give the handles for Drink Alsace. Okay, so they are based in New York, but they're all about Alsatian wines. So their Twitter is Drink Alsace, and I'll put this up in the when I do the edits or whatever. Their Instagram is also Drink Alsace, and you can do the hashtag Drink Alsace. So if you're watching the show, please tag along and tweet and Instagram us. And on Facebook, they are Wines of Alsace USA. So go ahead and tweet them. Give them some shout outs because they're all about Alsatian wines. Delish. Yes, so I am drinking a Gewürztraminer.
Okay.
I can't remember. Right, yeah. I can't remember the last time I had a Gewürztraminer, but I got this from Costco. I think.
But you got the right one.
Is this a good brand?
It is.
Oh, yay. So am I saying this right? Lucien Albrecht, is that how you say it?
Well, you know, in French, people don't like to pronounce. They don't like to pronounce consonants. So.
Oh, okay. Right. So break it down.
So it's probably like Albrecht.
Okay.
Like like the rest of it's just in the throat. Like just throw away them last got consonants. Anything after that E, they're not doing it.
Got it. Okay. So this is an Alsatian Gewürztraminer, 2015. And I like it, and it's really good with food. So I had, like for dinner, I mean, I don't know, I was really black today. So I had, I can't even lie, I was just super black today. So I had greens.
Oh my God.
So I had greens and
I can't with you.
I had greens and like spicy turkey wings.
Oh, yeah.
And so this went really, really well, even though Gewürztraminers go fantastic with like Asian cuisine and like sushi and stuff like that.
Listen, I was just gonna say it is so good with that, like it with really Thai food.
It really is.
Or your little butter chicken if you know doing your Indian carry out.
Yes,
yeah. It's good.
It's so good. And this,
I put that with some shrimp egg foo young.
We are winning. But the thing about Gewürztraminers is one of the most aromatic wines.
I was getting ready to say, yeah.
One of the most aromatic wines. So on the nose, I got green apple. I got pear. It's floral. You get honey. You get like the spice element. Then on the palate, you just get this nice apple fruitiness, tropical spice. Oh, my God. It's so good. It's so good. I don't know why I don't drink this often. No, I do. It's because when I first started drinking wine, this is one of the wines that I automatically went to. So I had to give it a break for a while. But this is a really, really good wine. And like I said, I found it at Costco. It was probably about $12.99. And, yeah, it's a good buy. It was a good buy. It's a really good wine. Really good wine.
Yum.
Mm-hmm.
And then, as always, wines always taste very good by themselves, too.
Yes, they do.
Yeah.
If you don't cook.
Yes. But I think the thing about Alsatian wines is due to, you know, the climate and them, you know, being on the border of Germany and the mountains right there. Yeah. They have a little more acidity. And I feel like they have more like fruit sweetness, not like sugar sweetness, but more fruit sweetness.
Exactly.
So it goes well with spicy food and it so it goes well with your, that's why it goes well with your Indian foods, your like anything you have that's kind of spicy. It works kind of well with.
And the sugar level, the sweetness level in the wines from Alsace matter. Your dryer styles are going to go really nice with your shellfish and your fish and your creamy sauces. But then when you get fruitier, then you can go to your Asian cuisine, which are Thai, that have some spice and stuff like that. So, yeah, play around with. And the thing is, when I was doing research on Alsatian wines, they said it's a really great place to visit. I never even thought about going to Alsace.
But let's go.
So I thought about it. I thought about it only because I hear a lot about the Christmas market in Strasbourg, which is in Alsace. And so I thought about
the sound of music. Right,
listen. So I've heard about Strasbourg and Alsace from that. And it's funny because, you know, clearly when I heard about
here's the Julie Andrews.
What nobody think about wine? He was just trying to dance in a circle in the field of, like, flowers. But there's a, like, they have some of, like, they have one of the best Christmas markets on the
planet.
I can imagine the temperature is rather chilly, too.
It's probably, like, well, Fahrenheit is probably, like, 2 degrees, so.
Yeah.
It's probably that. I had to say Fahrenheit because people tell me here, like, oh my gosh, it's 2 degrees. And I'm like, oh wow, that sounds cold. They're like, that's actually fine. And they're like, Celsius. I'm like, no, I'm not trying to figure that out. Like, I have done some conversions in my life. Like, I know how tall I am in centimeters and I know how much I weigh in kilos, but like, Celsius, I'm not doing it. Yeah. That's too much, man. It's like so, plus 35 to 70.
So, Alsace is a semi-continental climate with cold and dry winters and hot summers. So, interesting.
Oh, and back to what when we were talking before, when I was trying to figure out like what that extra grape was that I couldn't think of. Schossler is what it was.
Wait, say it again.
Schossler.
And that
C-H-A-S-S-L-E?
C-H.
Spell the whole word.
Hold on. I'm about to spell it. C-H-A-S-S-E-L-A-S.
Yeah, I wouldn't have got that.
Right.
Okay, Schossler.
I had it, except for the S.
Oh, yes, okay. Schossler. It is also a grape that's popular in Switzerland. But it does grow in Alsace. And another one is Auxois. Is similar in style. It's similar in style to Chardonnay.
Okay. Wait, spell the last one. How you say Auxois?
A-U-X.
That one. Yeah, I've had that one.
Yeah, A-U-X-E-R-R-O-I-S.
Yes, I've had that one.
That's a good one. So I'm looking at my notes for this, so don't be like, oh my God, Tanisha, you type. Yeah, no, Tanisha has notes.
Tanisha, pronounce that one more time, because I saw that before, and I can never remember how to pronounce it.
Auxois.
Auxois.
Yeah, the R is, I mean, a French person saying it would be a little throatier with the R, but...
Right.
Yeah.
Interesting. Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, so, and again, like we said before, when it comes to Alsatian wines, they'll have the grape on the front. Auxois is similar to Chardonnay in style and flavor.
Okay.
So if somebody is like, oh, I like Chardonnay and that's kind of what I drink, or oh, I don't... you know how I feel about people who say they don't drink Chardonnay. I'm like, you need to just try some other Chardonnays. That's what you need to do.
Well, I feel that way about
people. I was like that for a while.
Well, I say that about people who say they don't drink anything.
Right.
Well, yeah. I mean, I understand it if they're like, oh, well, I don't really drink red wines. And then you ask them what they drink and they drink, you know, milder wines. Right. And I'm like, okay, well, I get that. Mm-hmm. You can't just jump from Riesling and then be like, oh, yeah, this is a Ross bomb. Yeah. You're gonna hate it.
But, I mean, can you even count on your hand how many times that you have changed somebody's palate by just showing them something new?
Yes.
I mean, really.
I ran out of hands.
I don't have that.
I ran out of hands.
Exactly.
I only have 10 fingers and toes.
All I have. But you know, it's sad because people get so caught up in what they're used to.
Sure.
I don't think they really understand. When I do wine tastings for people, I said, you paid to get in here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You might as well taste it because you've already paid for it. Yeah. And it's okay. It's the culture of wine tasting to pour it out. Mm-hmm. And
that's the thing. In those kind of situations, drink everything. Like, try it.
Because
that's how you understand. At the very least, you know that these are 5 wines that I'll never drink again and that I don't like.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Right. Exactly.
But if you don't try things, then you don't know what else you will like. Mm-hmm. Like, it's nothing wrong if you drink Moscato, Riesling, like whatever. But the thing is, there are like 1,000 grapes.
Right.
You can't, like, why would you just limit yourself to 2?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
But I do understand that. You don't think that you may like something else because while there are so many grapes, it's hard to like just go to the shelf and be like, okay, which one will I like?
Right.
Okay, let me pick up this one. Mm-hmm. This label is dope. I'm gonna pick this one up. Yeah. Oh, I just spent $25 on this. I bought it. I drank it. Well, this is terrible. I'm gonna pour the rest down the drain.
Right. Right.
No. Okay. Make some salad dressing.
Yeah. Do something.
Right. Yeah. Like, we think that.
But
Or sangria, throw some fruit in it. Anything is delicious. Throw some fruit and some Hennessy in it.
I was talking to a coworker earlier who is, I mean, she likes wine, but she hasn't really been exposed to a whole bunch of it. So she said, well, where do I learn? I don't know where
call
to go.
Us.
Where?
Call us. What are you saying? You call us.
But
do you
have like,
an entire podcast? Right. Does she not have a sleep?
Hire us.
But what? She was like, I wouldn't even know where to open it because everywhere she goes, she's overwhelmed. She'll go to Total Wine. She's like, listen, I just had a full day of work. I'm just coming to get my beer and a wine that I know, and I'm going to walk up out of here. I don't feel like doing all that. And I was just like, honestly, Total Wine is not always the place for you to learn something new because of the setting.
Right.
Because they're trying to sell you something. So I was just like, you got to branch out. Try another wine shop, a smaller one where they have the distributor there, you know, explain the wine to you. And you just got to go balls to the wall sometimes. And you just got to buy something you don't know.
Sometimes
you got to take that L. You're going to find something great.
Get to know the small people. Exactly. Get to know the people in the smaller shop.
Yeah. Well, she lives in Laurel.
Over time, when you get more
confident.
She
lives in Laurel?
She lives in Laurel, so she either, I mean, she's in between, like, Old Line and then Total Wine.
Well, Old Line has wine
tastes. Right, and that's where I told her to go.
All the time.
Yeah.
And it's not as...
like that, you got to go and taste. You just have to go to the free tasting and taste stuff.
And Old Line is not like Total, where it's just like people all over you and they're just pouring in those little stinky plastic cups, you know. Online is a little better,
and
it's more intimate.
I be so burnt when they pour it in a plastic cup. Yeah, when they pour me listen, I just happen to have it. This is my water cup.
Yeah.
So when somebody pours me something, it be in there.
You know what? I'm going to start just walking around with my glass because I just have an attitude in plastic.
Wait,
I be so burnt.
Wait, because some folks do that. They do.
I'm telling you.
I'll drink it out of the picnic. If I'm at a picnic,
talk about that.
You can pour it in this at a picnic. But if I'm at like your official tasting at a wine shop or at a bar or anything like that.
But listen, at Paul's.
It's dark. What are you doing?
At Paul's uptown, They got right. regulars because their tastings are consistently every Friday night, no doubt. They have regular folks Friday that come night. In there that,
just for the tasting.
That come in for the Three tastings games. To start their night. And they're like 50 and over. This ain't party folks. Oh. These are folks who live in a neighborhood like, well, this is what we do. I have my glass. No plastic cup for me because I bought my own. I know the wines are going to be spectacular, so I brought my own glass. It's around my neck, and I'm going to taste all these wines because sometimes
they want the full experience.
They want the full experience, and sometimes
they're
going to
go home and watch
Netflix, have like three tables of tastings.
Yep.
Paul's will have three tables of tastings, and you
weaving in and out those boxes.
Exactly. Uh-huh. Yep. Yeah. The French man in the French suit pouring the French wine, you gonna mm-hmm. get your experience.
Exactly.
The mustache goes like this, listen, then you know it's real.
Listen, so if you just
gotta
turns
find. Up, you know it's yeah. real.
Yeah, and that's Paul's on on Wisconsin Avenue in Chevy Chase. Okay, shout out.
Yeah, we give him a shout out.
Yeah, we give him a shout out.
I'm not giving that shout out to where I bought this one from.
Listen,
you don't have to.
And you know where this is too, Serena. If I, you know, I'll tell you later.
Okay,
girl, slide in my DMs and tell me.
I want to hit a T. Yes, I want
to hit a T. Slide in the DMs.
Yeah,
it goes down in my DMs.
When I say, you could be like, that's right.
Oh,
but
man,
this Cremant is phenomenal, though. Yeah. Cremant is my go-to. I'm telling you.
Oh, I love
people
Cremant.
Don't sleep on Cremant.
Please don't sleep on Cremant.
This particular domain has a 100% Pinot Noir rosé. Mm. And I am looking for it. So domain, Zinck, because I don't want
to
screw it up. If you are watching,
let me see if I can find it.
Us,
oh,
please send us.
One of my good friends is from Alsace. She's from Strasbourg.
Oh, my gosh.
I hear the sound of music. Oh, every time you say Strasbourg.
Right, and there, and so it's vacation here. The students are on vacation. Listen, French school is on vacation. For every 6 weeks, they're out for two. Wow.
I love it.
They're out for 2 weeks. And then also, you know, it's the Easter holidays coming up, so they're out, whatever.
I love it.
So people are out. So a good friend of mine is from Strasbourg. And she goes home often. So next time she goes, I'll have to have her find that.
I want Zinck, the root, the 100% Pinot Noir Rosé, please.
I'll tell her specifically, I'll say, you need to look for this. Yeah. She'd be like, oh, but it's like 40 minutes from my home. I'm like, yeah, well, you drove 3 hours to Alsace, so 40 minutes, what the
Stop it. So neither one of you guys have been to Alsace?
No.
Okay. Got it. So, Tanisha, how far is it from you? From
right.
Paris?
I don't think it's that far.
Okay.
Like, France is not, like, it's big, but it's not that big. Okay. I don't think, like, you can get to anything by train.
Train?
So,
okay.
I think it might be maybe a 4-hour train ride.
Oh. I'll have to ask
my friend.
Okay.
Who lives there, who drives home.
Drives?
So it can't,
wow.
Yeah,
wow.
Yeah, I'm like,
okay, so we have to plan a sweet meetup and just do this.
Yeah.
So
much.
Real talk. Yeah. Offline, we're gonna talk about
okay.
that.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Sorry. Okay. So back to this beautiful Cremant. Beautiful baby.
And so one thing I wanna say that people might not know about Cremant that I tell when I talk to people in classes or whatever. Cremant is all sparkling wines in France that are outside of Champagne.
Exactly.
Thank you.
So every time we talk Cremant, I'll always say this, but Champagne is a sparkling wine made in the Champagne method, made in the Champagne region.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
So it has to be made in the Champagne region to be called Champagne.
Exactly.
But if it is made in that same method in France, but in another region with different grapes, it is Cremant.
Cremant.
So Cremant d'Alsace, Cremant de Loire, Cremant de Bordeaux, Cremant de Bourgogne.
Cremant le Mou. Don't forget le Mou, where it all began.
Where it all began. Which Cremant le Mou is actually is actually a tasty, tasty sparkling wine.
That is my favorite. Okay, makes me excited.
I mean, just the saline flavors, the minerality, quality. The acidity.
Woo! They coined it. You know, when you have that masterpiece, and then you have the ones that come after, it's like they're good, but Cremant de Limoux, phenomenal.
It's just interesting how. And this is why wine fascinates me so much, because you have the same method, but if you take a different grape and put it in this method, like if you take the grapes that can grow in Alsace, whether it be Gewürztraminer or Riesling or Sylvaner or Pinot Noir, and you make the Cremant with that versus like Bordeaux, which is Sauvignon Blanc or Semillon or
Cabernet. Yum!
Or any of the wines from Loire. Like, they all taste so distinctly different.
Sure.
They have such different flavors and such different characteristics.
You are preaching like the gospel, my
wine. Like, that's why I got into wine, because I just didn't, like, when I first heard about, like, I talked to a winemaker when I was at a Maryland Wine Festival, and I was like, wait, so why does it taste like cherries, and what are these other flavors? Like, that's just how it is.
Yeah.
You know, so do you have, like, a cherry tree?
Like, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, like, I was so confused. Yeah. I didn't understand.
But you know, the funny thing is, when I talk to people that don't understand, like, grapes and wine and how the whole process is, because I'm in, you know, I have a health background, I'll say, listen, I'm from Southeast D.C. Do I talk like it? Nah. My roots are different. I've grown in a different area. It's the same thing with grapes.
Exactly.
It's the same thing.
Strange.
And I'm all like, hurt.
But you know, Tanisha and Sarita, you hit the nail on the head. There's a couple things that I want to bring home here. One, okay, I might be limiting my invitations to the Loire, but I don't like Cremants from the Loire.
Really?
And maybe it might be the houses I don't. I like wine from the Loire, but the Cremant itself from Loire, I just don't like. And you made a great point when you talk about the cherry tree and when you first, well, what do you mean do you taste it? It's what your brain recognizes. It's all the perception. It's all your makeup, because what you taste and what you perceive is something totally different than I may. Only if I have tasted those entities as well will I recognize them. If I haven't, it's going to be like, And unless I've tasted it as well, I'm not going to recognize. And that's just human nature and what the brain has been introduced to previous.
Right.
That's the nerd of me.
And that's a good point, because a lot of times when, like, I see someone who's a really good taster, I assume that they're just born with this fucking skill that I don't have, but they're like, oh no, girl, do you know how many wines I've tasted throughout my years? This is practice. I was not born with this. I did not just pick up a bottle of wine and just start drinking. I had to practice this and recognize certain things. I went through the grocery stores and smelled all the fruits. I've been through all the valleys and smelled all the plants. So this is, it's a form of work, and that I don't think people understand.
Exactly.
And I think they romanticize it a little too much, but you know.
I totally agree. I totally agree. You have to taste things in its natural state and not in its enhanced state.
Right.
So, you know, not blueberries from a compote. Blueberries naturally out of a field in its natural state.
Sure.
Canes, raspberries, all the different flavors. And you know, I was talking to Deborah Meberg about this. I was like, oh my God, how do you do this? What's going on? And there's tasting, and Deborah Wong as well, she's developing a tasting kit of all these, I mean, from a natural, not the artificial, because there's tasting kits out there that have artificial flavors, which are totally different from the natural, she was telling me. And she said, you've got to get it in its most natural state for your brain to recognize it later in mind.
Yeah.
So,
Absolutely.
Yeah. So I got to figure out the best one to purchase and up my little skills as well.
Yeah.
So, yay, this was a cool. Cremant.
So, if we want to leave the people with a little information about Alsace and, you know, like what wines they should try from Alsace. What would you say? We have a Gewürztraminer, we have a Cremant. What else would you say, like, kind of overall about wines from Alsace that makes them different from other wines within maybe France or the
world? Well, you definitely got to do a Riesling from Alsace.
Of course.
For sure.
Of course. Sure. And don't turn it away just because it says dry on the bottle.
Exactly.
Don't turn it away because dry doesn't necessarily mean dry.
Offensively dry.
It's not.
Don't think sweet.
Mm-mm.
Because well-made Rieslings from well-made Rieslings, period.
Yeah.
And from Alsace, you're going to enjoy it.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. I would say, think about, if you're having dinner, especially it's summer, it's about to get hot, you about to pull out the shellfish, the mussels, the clams, the seafood, try Alsace. Just try it.
Yes.
You got to try it. It's going to be fantastic. It's going to be fantastic.
Yeah.
Especially with this area being so close to the water. Just saying. It's going to be fantastic.
It only enhances it.
Only. Oh, it's going to be fantastic.
Only enhances it.
Oh, I can't
wait. The experience.
Ooh. Mm. And you, Tanisha, did you have any last words?
No, I feel like I've interjected enough. Sorry for those I interrupted. Thank you for letting me interrupt you. And I apologize if I was, whatever.
Yeah.
No, but you taught very well as usual, my
as
dear.
Usual.
No, I just try to give, some information and then, along with the jokes. I don't wanna, just be the court jester. I wanna be the
Oh my god. So I got a few shout outs before we go.
Shout out
shout outs. So I wanna give a shout out to Upscale with Princess Penny. So this guy, he is a writer on Insecure, okay? So he's a writer for Insecure. He's done several other shows. And he has a new show called Upscale with Princess Penny on True TV.
You told me about this.
His show is so fabulous because his show is basically, he's trying to upscale his life in every possible way. And on episode one, I didn't know what this show was, but on episode one, he had D. Lynn Proctor showing him sparkling wines in California just to upscale his wine game.
Come back.
So all I'm saying, upscale with Princess Penny. He's a black guy. He's a writer for Insecure. And on episode one, he goes to a candle shop. He goes to a chick that shows him, like, did I say chick? That's probably not appropriate. But he goes to a woman who has, like, makes sheets or something. Anyway, but his last stop is
it's your show. You can say what you want to say.
His last stop, he goes to wine country and has D. Lynn showing him champagne and sparkling
because you
wine.
Just said the magic words and to make me I'm be saying, completely wait, inappropriate. So, you wait. Already know.
If you don't know, D-Lynn is fine as I don't know what. He's fine.
So when
He's
you fine. Say wine country, was it in the U.S. wine country? Was it French wine?
He was in California.
California at the time?
Everything that he touches, everything that he goes to is in California because that's where he's from.
So okay.
I think he just like explores California. But yeah, wow. So he's doing, like I said, he went to a candle shop. A lady who like does like sheets or something like that, and like the thing is I'm lit because me and Alan were watching his episode 3, and he went to a cocktail shop where the guy sells everything all about cocktails, the bitters, the glasses, the stirs,
oh, wow.
Like everything else, and so they made old fashions. The next thing you know, we making old fashions. That's how.
But
that's how great the show is because everything on the show is like, oh, I'm about to do that. I'm about to do that. That's how it makes you feel life. Like I'm about to upgrade my life. So yeah, shout out to Princess Penny because that's bomb. It's bomb. Shout out to, I gotta give Stubb a shout out. So shout out to Jason Stubblefield. He did a great job this weekend. He was interviewing for a drinking intern position that he's trying to apply for, where he's going to travel all around the world and taste all types of beer.
Phenomenal.
We showed up for him, and all the interviews for the semifinalists were live at World of Beer in Rockville.
I can't imagine
being interviewed in front of a crowd of people. And he had the biggest crowd. He gave us all t-shirts, and we were, you know, screaming and yelling. But there were some really tough questions that, yeah, he really handled very well. So I hope he gets the position, because that seems amazing. That seems amazing.
Here's to you, Stubb.
And shout out to the guy, the black guy who won last year. Last year. I forgot his name.
That we ain't know about.
Right. But I'm about to tweet him, because two black guys won last year, and they traveled the world trying different beers. And they have, I don't know if they have a podcast, but they have a blog where they match wines with different albums. And I think it's called One Beer, One Album. Awesome. Awesome.
Oh, yeah. That's nice.
So we got to get him on the show. But shout out to that. Shout out to beer. I'm not a beer
drinker,
but
I appreciate that. Talk about the two beers that I like. Right. About the two beers I like.
Yeah. So I wonder if there's like a wine thing that's like that.
That's the same thing that Alan said. I was like, I don't know. I ain't never heard of such. But
right. Wow. She was like, I want it.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, that would be outstanding. Mm-hmm. That would be outstanding.
It really would. It really would.
Sabrina would be so good for it. She'd be like, I'm going for it.
Girl.
I'll say it. At Drink Alsace, this was phenomenal.
Yes.
And sorry they couldn't be with us tonight.
Yes.
Yeah, that's okay. You're with us in spirit. You're with us in tweets.
But if you're watching, please tweet them. Please hashtag them. Drink Alsace, and yes, please go drink Alsace, because the wines are fantastic.
Exactly.
Yes.
Yay, here's to you all.
Cheers.
Yeah, I don't have anything to put up, but yeah, y'all got me.